Hey guys, and welcome back to It's Out, your music podcast. I'm really hyped right now. I have a really special guest, Conan Gray.
Hi.
Hi, you're like, peace.
I'm
what's
hyped
up?
Too. Look, it is 10 in the morning, and I did just wake up like 30 minutes ago, but I'm hyped.
You woke up like this.
I woke up like this.
But you look fresh, though.
Fresh, thank you.
Yeah, what
thank
the
you.
Hell?
I slept a lot, but
did
I've
you?
Been so jet-lagged for like 6 days. I don't know
I was
why.
Gonna say, but what do you mean why? You're in Berlin, you're like from the U.S.
Yeah, but normally it takes like 2 days and then yeah. you're fine. But yeah. now I'm like, I feel crazy right now.
You must be like delusional and just like
I'm
super.
Delusional, like I might have just made you up.
I'm like, we are really not here. Mm-mm. Wake up.
Mm-mm.
That's so, but I feel like sometimes when you're delusional and super tired, especially on these like PR trips and for your album and all that stuff, it's just... You say the funniest stuff, and you come, it's just...
You say that, well, I say dumb stuff.
Yeah, but you don't overthink it, and it's
and
kind
I
of, you're
back.
In this dream state.
Yeah. I look back, I'm like, what? Why did I say that? Or I overshare. Because sometimes I forget. You know, like, when you're doing so much promo, you kind of forget that, like, you're ever going to go on tour. Like, you forget that, like, people are going to actually see everything.
Yeah, yeah.
So I've been like, oh, and then, like, this happens, and I'm like... Can you just shut up for 1 second?
True, and you're like oversharing, and then there's nothing left. Like,
yeah, and then like, and then all of a sudden, someone in Berlin, Germany, is like, "Hey, did you get dumped on an airplane?" And I'm like, "Right, I said that."
True, you said that.
I said that.
Oh
Why
my god!
I that?
Yeah. But I love that about you because I mean, there's this, you know, when you're trying to be mysterious and you're like, I'm "Today not. I'm gonna be mysterious," and you try for 10 minutes.
Yeah, you're like.
Yeah, literally. I need some blue light. I was gonna do like a vocal rest this whole morning. When people talk to me, I'm not gonna shut up.
No,
I can't
I
be
love
like
talking. Learns sign language.
Sign language. Yeah, but I was talking about the dream state thing earlier. How do you love to write your songs? Like at night, do you get the most creative when you're alone, or do you prefer like a 10 a.m. session?
Oh my god, I'd rather kill myself than be in session.
Okay, good to know.
Whoa.
Kind of sociopathic of
nightmare,
you.
Nightmare situation. I have a routine. I usually, these days, I'll like wake up, get a coffee or make coffee, and then I lay all the blankets in my house on the floor.
Oof.
In my living room, and then I sit down and I write for like... I write for like an hour, 2 hours every morning. And if I have something to say, it'll usually come pretty fast. And if not, then I just will be like, okay, well, not today.
Nice.
But I try every day just because it's my favorite thing to do.
Yeah.
It's not like I'm not like, oh, grind never stops. Mm. It's just like I just like it.
I love that though.
And when I'm like traveling and stuff like that, I like miss it.
Wow. It's a nice ritual though. Like, so your mind is getting used to it and it's kind of like this muscle that you keep training, but it's also not really, like you said, not that it's, you just love it.
Yeah, I also think that, like, you know, you keep training, keep learning, da, 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 but then there's also like times where you're like, okay, like I don't need to write right now. I'm not nothing's happening in my life. I don't really need anything to say. So it is like kind of like bursts of time, right? Yeah.
When did you learn that? Because I feel like knowing that, okay, I don't have to write every single day. I don't have to do this. Because I would sometimes get mad at myself and I go, oh, why isn't anything coming out of my mouth right now? There's no way. Or when there's a lot of things going on, and you're like, why is this like, it's not even a writer's block. It's just sometimes you don't know what to say or how to say it.
How to say it.
Yeah.
That's the thing. I don't know if you've like noticed this, but I've definitely noticed that I usually take like a year or so after something has happened for me to actually be able to write about it.
Interesting.
Like in the truest state. You know, like, I might, like, be able to write about, like, anger, or, like, I might be able to write about, like, more immediate emotions.
Like, the impulsive type of...
Exactly.
Yeah.
But then, like, when it comes to actually talking about the situation, it takes me, like, 6 months to a year before I can really get, like, a really good song about it.
Wow,
and
okay.
So sometimes I'm, like, if I'm going through a lot of stuff, I'm, like, oh, I don't need to write right now. I know I'll write about this in 6 months and write, like, a better song about it than I would write right now.
Mm-hmm. Because then it's, like, too cluttered and you're, like, right in the moment and you're not really reflected. Like, you're just being sometimes...
An asshole.
Good. Yeah. I was going to say this about myself, but it seemed like I was saying it to you. So I was, like, you're just being...
You're being an asshole.
You're being an asshole. Yeah, but it's sometimes good to be, like... you can look at it from another perspective.
Yeah.
I talked about this with Fletcher. It was more of like a, you're being really like mature about it, and you can be grown up and healed and talk about it from a healed place rather than like a, okay, this happened yesterday.
Yeah.
You fucking cheater.
Fuck you. Like, yeah, because it's, that's also like, when it comes to love, especially, like, mm-hmm, that's not the real emotion. Like, what it really is, like, you feel hurt or you feel abandoned. Exactly. Yeah. And so, it's like, you know, whenever I'm, like, in that mood, I'm like, oh, fuck you. That's, you, like, you, I'm, mm-hmm, like, maybe I can write, like, one song about it, but no one wants to hear an album that's like, fuck you, you asshole. Like, everyone, you know, you need depth.
True, you need some depth, some dynamic in there.
Yeah.
But I feel like it also depends on, when you say that people don't want an album like that, your niche is, like, what you created, and you have this beautiful, like, little world. And I feel like right now you've opened up a complete new world with this album. Dude, my ears were, like, in heaven. Like, I was just chilling in heaven for, like, a good 13 songs.
Yeah, a good 13 songs of, like, what?
I was like, wow. It was like a time capsule. That's how I would describe it.
Yeah, and it's all very much like, I did want to make an album that sounded like only an album.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
It's, like, closed.
For sure.
Like, it doesn't sound like other stuff, and I don't necessarily think that, like, my next stuff will sound like it.
Which
it's just,
have
I just
to.
Wanted to make a little...
It's literally, the bow is on, and it's like,
tied a bow. Here you go.
That's exactly the thing that I got, and I love it.
Thank you.
Of course. It's like, it's amazing. How did the first initial spark come of, like, ooh, I want to make this, like, a retro 80s baddie album?
So I started writing songs for it when I was on tour a year and a half ago.
Mm-hmm.
And I was, like, playing all these theaters, like, you know, like, those, like, seated old-fashioned theaters, and they always have a piano in the basement for all the orchestra, like, things, or, like, all the symphonies and stuff. And so I would go, and I'd ask, like, oh, can I, after the show, can I go into the basement and, like, play the piano? So I would play, like, I'd write after the shows.
Mm-hmm. By yourself.
By myself, just in my pajamas, like, in the basement, like Gremlin.
I love that, but you got little downtime from like all
I
the
did.
Ups and like the.
Because it's a lot to be like on tour, and then, I basically just started from there, and then the first song that I was like, oh, like this might be an album was, the title track of the album, Found Heaven. That was the first time that I was like, oh, okay, like I think I get that this might actually be like a little something different.
Yeah.
Just because I remember writing that song and being like, huh, like, I've never written a song like that in my life. Like, this sounds really strange.
Wow.
At the time, I was just kind of in a silly mood. And I was
Silly,
goofy mood. And I was falling in love. And I was kind of watching life change a lot around me. And I was like, okay, I have to make an album that I think represents how different I feel right now.
Mm-hmm.
And then just like... something that can show people that people change.
That's beautiful. I feel like it's kind of like a movie soundtrack to that era of you.
Yeah.
It's super intense, and the whole buildup of the production and your vocals, it's just like, here I am.
Thank you. And now that it's over, like now that I made the album, I'm like, damn, was it that serious? Like,
you look back.
I look back and I'm like, Jesus, like, I was really going through, like, this, like, crazy, I don't know, like, transformative experience at that time, and now that it's, like, now that, like, that, once I finished the album,
I was like,
I'm coming down now, and I'm, like, looking back, and I'm like, what? It's been really interesting, because, like, it is so different than what I would normally do, and I like that it's, like, yeah, it's, like, this little...
Mm-hmm.
Present. That's it's, like everything's the same inside of it. It's this little like just taste of something different.
Yeah, for sure. It's like the same, but also every song's different.
Yes, yes. They're all over the place.
Love that though.
Yeah.
What song would you say represents you right now the best?
Right now, I'd say Allie Rose.
Oh, shut up! Shut up! Wait, that is my favorite one.
That's my favorite one.
Stop it! That is my favorite one on the album. Yeah. It's. I can't even describe the melodies. Like, they just itch this spot on my brain.
Thanks. I love it. That was the last one that I wrote for the album.
No way.
So I think since it was the last one, I basically was like, oh, I wrote the song. And then afterwards, I was like, okay, that's it. That's yeah. all the album is.
We're like, done.
We're done. We're
I've given everything.
Yeah. And yeah. it's just my favorite too, because I think it was my, like, 6 months later, like a little bit of like retrospect and kind of being able to look and be like, oh, okay. So I understand now what happened with this relationship and stuff.
Ah, nice. Yeah. It's very like nostalgic in a way, that song.
Yeah.
You're
kind of
looking back.
It's kind of looking back and also being like, what?
Yeah, what the fuck?
The whole time I was just like, what the fuck? Where did you go?
where are you?
Where did you go, Allie Rose? Like, where Allie are Rose. You?
Allie Rose is a person, or is it more of a metaphor for, like, a feeling? I'm just like...
So this is actually a funny story.
Okay.
So I wrote the song in London. Oh, this is me gonna overshare again.
Shout out
London.
London things.
London
things. Sorry.
London Bridge falling down.
Yep.
So I wrote the song. Since I already shared this, I'm just...
Just go ahead. Safe space.
This is a safe public space.
Which is like, it's just us.
Always. No. It's just us.
It's just us.
And
no man. 8
billion
no.
people. It's fine.
What? What are you talking about?
No, so when I got... So I was dating this person, and then mm-hmm. they dumped me while I was... flying on a plane to London to see them.
Mm.
Then I was in London, dumped, and I was really sad, and I was like...
Huh. And you went for them?
I was going to visit them because
super
we were
duper.
Seeing each other, I don't know.
Just like...
Everything was normal, I don't know.
until it wasn't.
Until it wasn't, which is how most things in life go, right?
Yeah.
And then, super. Basically, then I was in London, and I was like, oh, shoot, like I... don't have anything to do. And then I was like, I'm literally like on Abbey Road right now, but I don't
Abbey
have,
Road.
Abbey Road. And but I don't have anywhere to go. And so the song was originally Where'd You Go Abbey Road, because I wrote it while I was in London. But then I was like, oh, I probably shouldn't name like my favorite song on this album after like one of the most famous albums of all time. So, probably. And so I was like, okay, how can I, like, change this into something that, like, still has the same rhyme as Abbey Road, but, like, can mean something different? And I was like, oh, I should just, like, make up, like, something that sounds like a name. Because I want, when you listen to the song, I want you to, like, think of someone. You know, I want someone to, like, you know, I feel like everyone has one person who pops up into their mind when they hear that song. And so, I chose Allie. Because of a reason that I'm sure I'm going to say at one point.
At one point, maybe not today. I'll ask you later.
Ask me later.
I just want to know.
And then Rose, just because it's, you know, I think roses represent love. And
sounds cute. It's like an aesthetic word.
Yeah. No, I'll share the reason why. I'm sure I'm going to say it like 1,000 times during this press. Basically, our first kiss happened in an alleyway. Uh-huh. So it's actually like alley. Uh-huh. Like an alley.
Wait, but I love that. No, I love that. Because it makes it so personal to you. Like, even though you shared it.
I shared it. But that's the thing.
It's not like where it already happened, you know?
It already happened.
We're just like looking back at it. Yeah, it happened. It happened.
Yeah, and to me it was just kind of like a little way of churning it into more of my own thing as well. And I just also, it made me laugh. I'm like, LOL, that's hilarious.
Yeah, while you're performing, that, like, you're like, lol.
LOL, Allie Rose, like as in like an alleyway.
Yeah, no, it's great.
I just think, it's like, it made me laugh. And when I sent it to my friends, obviously my friends like know everything that goes on in my life. Like when I sent it to my friends, they were like dying of laughter. I was like, okay.
See the insiders, it's beautiful.
Yeah, it just makes you smile. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that's a funny thing, because what was your like friends' reactions from the first time that you showed them one of the first demos that were in this like 80s retro vibe? What did they say?
They were very excited and very surprised. And my main intention with this whole album is just to surprise people.
Yeah. You know, you will.
I hope so.
You will.
It's my third album, and I never even thought I would be able to make 3 albums. So I wanted to take it as an opportunity to just try something different.
I'm interested in how your producer team, if you had like this core team in LA or wherever you go to produce, did you keep that and you were like, let's do this now, or did you reach out to new people where you'd be like, okay, they could encapsulate the sound way better than maybe the people that I did my sad stuff with, for example.
So I did reach out to a few different people, not a ton. I kind of knew who I wanted to work with. And basically, I knew I wanted to work with Greg Kirsten, just because I've been such a fan of his work for so many years. And then it's basically, yeah, Greg Kirsten, then Max Martin, and then one other guy named Sean Everett. And they were the only three people that I reached out to. And I was like, I just want to make an album with you guys and just kind of
you down.
Yeah. And then it was, yeah, it was really cool. I made, so I did like 6 months in Sweden.
Cute. Love Sweden. Did you like Sweden?
Love Sweden.
Isn't it a great escape from LA?
It's a great escape from LA. It's just also just like Stockholm is like one of the best cities in the world.
Yeah.
It's so great.
Yeah, and Swedish people have this vein. Like, Swedish producers are, I don't know why. I've been talking about this with a lot of people. It's like something else is running through their veins.
Yeah, I know. I've like thought about it because now I have all these Swedish friends and we've talked about it a lot. And their theory is, I think what makes a really great pop song is when there's like a little bit of sadness. And I don't know if you've ever, I don't know why you would have ever looked into like Swedish, like Swedish, like the children's songs that they sing.
I have
like
yet.
All super depressing.
You're kidding.
But they're like little kids and they're like singing all these like really depressing, but they're like really nostalgic for them and really happy to them. And so like when they express their like happiness, there's always like a little tinge of sadness. And I think that's what makes like an amazing pop song is like, you know, Dancing on My Own, who Swedish, Robin is Swedish.
Yeah.
You know, that there's that little like, yeah, it's sad, but it's also happy, but it's sad. Yeah. And I think that's, but
that
also
kind of contrast, that's
their other theory is that the language Swedish itself is like super melodic.
They do speak like, hard in the truth.
It's like very like up and down and very like, and so they're always like, yeah, maybe it's because we talk like.
It could be, but that would be, I don't know, I just can't rest without knowing, like, how are Swedish people so talented
in
music? It's insane. I had this one theory that was like, it's just because it's stupid. I was like, because they're so happy, the Swedish people. No, because the Scandinavian people, they're just like, if you go to Germany, I don't know if you've noticed, you've probably been to Berlin a couple times and just Germany and tour and all that stuff. People are mad here. Like,
yes,
we're
mad. They're mad.
I'm not mad, but people are mad.
Yeah, and they're very, like, blunt, which I like.
Yeah, I love that. But it's honest. You know where you're at. No one's going to be like, in LA, they're like, hi, sweetie, love you. I'm like, I just met you, bro.
Yeah.
Bro. What are you talking about?
I don't know. You don't love me. You don't know me.
Yeah. What? But Swedish people are very much, like, they have this calmness and this super nice energy. Yeah. I can't even explain it.
Yeah, they're very, and also, like, if you think about them as like as a people as a whole, like since they spend their entire winter in complete darkness.
True. How are you? They're compensating.
So then the summer comes and they're just so fucking happy that there's light.
Yeah.
And so like they're like, yes.
Vitamin
D. So they kind of concentrate all their sadness into like the winter months, and then the rest of the year they're just so stoked that like they can see things.
We just go on a tangent on like Swedish people for hours.
Oh my god, I could talk about Sweden forever.
Yeah. Did you produce in the summer there or spring?
It was the fall and the summer. And it was a really, really funny, weird time, too, because I was really sick the whole summer. I was really sick the whole summer and the whole fall. And so I would, like, go from, like, being, like, super, super ill to, like, just being a little bit good enough to sing, like, some vocals. And then I would go back and, like, die in my bed for, like, another 3 weeks. It was horrible.
No.
But basically, like, I'd gotten the flu from someone, and then...
Who are you? We have to find you.
I know who it is.
Uh-oh.
Demon. and then the flu turned into, like, a sinus infection, and then it turned into a lung infection.
Who gets
a lung infection?
Sorry, who?
Who does that? That's crazy. And then from there... It turned into my tonsils got like chronically infected, and then I had to get them taken out
in Sweden.
No, I did it in LA. Thank God.
But you had to fly with a
because they were infected for like 4 months.
How do you deserve? Like, how did you deserve this? What karma did you?
I do not like, know. What? I am paying for something. It was just really interesting and a huge growth period for sure.
Mm, love that reflection moment.
Yeah, love to reflect.
Love that. Maybe your past self was just like a douchebag. Like maybe. In your earlier lives,
yeah,
you know?
Earlier lives, I like murdered a lot of people or something.
You were like Ted Never Bundy. Welcome, guys. This isn't just going to be great. Ted Bundy. I don't know why I'm just. It's the voice thing it's with me too.
Yeah, ever since you had this voice, you've just been crazy.
I've just been a new person. I'm Emma. Emma Chamberlain. Did you record the vocals new again when you were in LA, or did you just keep those?
I had to redo some of them, but on most of them, I'm sick.
Girl, okay.
Yeah.
I can't. Super. Thank Everyone, you. That's Thank amazing. You.
It was literally You're so crispy. Miserable. It was miserable.
I'm so sorry for you.
It was, you know what I think it is? I was the happiest that I've ever been in my entire life when I started the album.
Yeah.
And everything that goes up has to come down. And since I went so high and I was so happy and I was in love and everything was so great and all my dreams were coming true and I was like, this is amazing. You know, the fall was really hard.
The fall was very,
very much
low.
Low.
Oh no, I'm so sorry for you.
But I think that's what it was. I think that's what, you know, everything has to even out.
Yeah, there has to be a balance.
Now I'm back to just being like normal.
Are you like?
I'm just vibing now.
Okay, good.
Okay, here I am.
Good.
I like look back and I'm like, what the fuck was that? but yeah.
That's good. I have one thing that interests me because if we look into kind of the whole concept of this album, it seems very just inspired. Where did that come from, the 80s inspiration? Did your parents kind of, did you grow up with that type of music or?
Well, I didn't grow up with any pop music at all. I was like mostly raised by my mom and she, we like only
Hashtag same.
Hashtag same.
We love mothers.
Love a mom. Mm-hmm. And we only listen to like Christian music. I was only allowed to listen to Christian music until.
What's that like?
I don't know. It sounds just like pop music, but then it's like Jesus, and you're like, what?
Justin Bieber, but Jesus, like.
Yeah, it's like as long as you're Jesus.
We could be holy.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're writing a smash.
We're writing a Jesus song.
Christmas.
Christmas song.
Writing Christmas.
Christmas is Christian. You're onto something.
I think it's pagan, actually.
Pagan?
Yeah, it's like not a Christian holiday.
Am I living under a rock?
What? Am I living under a rock? So I didn't have 80s music, but it's more like in my adulthood, I've learned all about like the 70s and 80s. I've kind of had to learn afterwards, which has been really great because like I get to discover like the best music ever made now. Like it's new. I'm like, have y'all heard the song?
And they're like,
Bohemian Rhapsody? And they're like, yeah.
We've been here. Like,
I'm like, have you guys fucking heard like
Sting?
Have you guys heard of Sting? And everyone's like, yes. And I'm like, me too, for sure.
But it's nice, honestly. It's like you.
It's so fun.
New stuff is great because I feel like there's so many just like things where like, oh, I'm so bored.
Yeah. I'm like, have you guys heard Elton John? Yes. Yes, they've heard Elton John. But like, dude, I didn't know moved out and had my own life.
Mm-hmm. Who's your fave? Sorry, I didn't want to interrupt you. Yeah.
Oh.
Maybe top two.
I love Bowie. Mm.
Did you watch the documentary?
I didn't. I haven't watched it.
You're gonna die.
Is it really good?
It's super, like, after you get this high, you're like, okay, let's go. Like, I just, it's insane.
Yeah. I love Elton. I love Dolly Parton.
Ooh.
Dolly Parton's, like, kind of my favorite of all time. I love her so much.
The fact that she played the guitar with her nails still.
I still don't understand. And she's not even just, like, strumming. She's like.
Yo, she's dead ass, like, riffs
it's
all the way.
Amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. But it was very interesting. And then I think since I was discovering all this.
I feel like it's super difficult sometimes to sometimes the audience is like, what the hell is going on? Do you hope to be like, oh, the adults can join in now? And like, I want to see the, not old people, I want to see them at the concert, because it's genuinely a very authentic album. Like, I could have been in the 80s and like turned on the radio and you would have, like, it's not like the Dua Lipa 80s. I love that, but it's very still pop washed. But this is like literally. So do you hope to get like the old people in, or are you like, I want the new generation to get this because you're missing out?
I think it was kind of more that, because I don't know. I wasn't really thinking. I was like, this is for the 50-year-olds. Yeah, like, no. I wasn't really thinking that. I was just kind of like, oh, I like these songs that I've discovered. And I'm just like, I think also when you only listen to like certain things, then it just kind of like leaks into your music. But I also, there's like music that I kind of feel like me and my friends like love old music. Mm-hmm. And so I didn't really think anything. I wasn't like, oh, I'm introducing Gen Z to like, it's not what I thought. I was just like, they love this song, like these songs too, right? Like, I didn't really think anything of it. But it's been really like interesting, because I think like less people know that much about like the 70s and 80s than I thought. And I think it's like kind of TikTok's fault, because like your For You page is so curated to you. So like I like was being fed so many like-minded people being like, yeah, like fucking everyone knows these songs. Turns out the answer's no. They don't. So then they're like, what is this? I'm like, what?
Yeah. And it's like the 2000s are kind of, you know, here in the 90s.
Yeah. It's also like everyone's only taking like, it's kind of funny because like, when you look back at old decades, like the best of the best kind of like rises to the top.
Yeah.
You forget that there's like a lot of shitty stuff from then too. It's like sometimes I'll hear like the worst song I've ever heard from the 2000s. And I'm like, what the fuck? Like, I'm so glad it's not the 2000s anymore. But then you hear like, like Promiscuous Girl. And you're like, whoa, this is fucking amazing. Fucking
Oh my God. Yeah. But we romanticize older eras, because it's like, obviously the trends that come up aren't going to be the shitty stuff.
Yeah. If there's one thing Gen Z is going to do, is romanticize.
Oh, yeah.
We could romanticize anything. We could, like, I get TikToks. Do you ever get these that it's like, like, I miss 2020 quarantine? And I'm like,
it's like core. The thing with like the core, like, the core. It's like, you're romanticizing, like.
That was a bad time.
Yeah. Although, it was horrible. Were you on House Party?
I was on House Party.
Oh my God. It was just a horrible time. Who was I?
It was a horrible time, but it was. There was something.
This little comfort thing that it's like we were locked in.
We were animals. Literally locked down. I don't know. I think also it's just like, we've never experienced that before. So it was like, it's definitely like memorable.
Totally.
Very memorable.
Totally. I'm moving out right now and I found like a mask in like a box. And I was like, whoa.
Or like I'll like find like a t-shirt that I wore from then, and I'm like, I wore that in 2020. Like, what? Also, 2020, 4 years ago.
Shut up. Don't say that.
Which does not make sense my mind.
What?
4 years ago. That's like, you could have graduated an entire college degree.
Bro, oh my God. We're going to be like the annoying grandmas and grandpas to our grandchildren that are like, back in the day.
Back in my day.
We wore masks and we had to take like tests and shit.
I still have to take tests all the time.
What?
Because it's like there's still,
it's still there.
Yeah, it's still around, and it's like.
I feel like we're just ignoring it now.
It's like, I wish I could. It's like, there's just so much of it, and I don't know. But it is weird. I look back and I'm like, there's a little part of me that romanticizes it. I think maybe it's our like coping mechanism.
Maybe it is.
I think so.
Our generation's so just fucked up. We're fucked up. Was it like your songwriting peak, or? Because we were just low. At home. Oh.
Worst.
Fuck.
Worst. Oh my God, it was so hard to get a song out.
There's no inspo. It's your walls.
I was only writing about the past.
Yeah.
It's like my whole album before Soup Break was literally all I wrote it all in quarantine. And I was just like, I have so little to say because I have so little to say about my current life.
Mm.
Because what the fuck is happening? House Party?
Nothing. House Party?
Fortnite House Party. That's it.
Was so fun.
It was so fun. Oh, I met a lot of interesting people.
Oh, yeah. Anyways, random people coming into the room. And you're like, what are...
Random people. And then like I've been, like, living my life afterwards. And they're like, I think I met you on House Party. Like, my friends.
Like, no, you didn't.
Like, oh, like, we met on House Party. I'm like, We did.
Oh, you did? No, you didn't. That was not me.
That was not me.
That was Gray.
That was Conan Gray.
Conan Gray. That was literally your name. Fuck. You don't like partying in general?
No. If the music's really good.
What would be like your ideal party music?
Well, it was my friend's birthday, mm-hmm. and like then we got to just like exclusively play like the smash hits of our.
You're like my playlist.
Okay. Literally, we were just like Spotify. Yeah. So like we want ABBA.
Mm-hmm.
We want ABBA.
You want them.
We want ABBA. We want MIA.
Oh.
We want Madonna.
Uh-huh. Where were these parties all along? Yeah.
Like we want the good good.
The good, just the good shit. It's just like it's not even a genre. It's just the good
good.
The good good.
We just want the good good. Don't give me any.
Yeah.
Stop with all the bullshit. Give me the good good.
Yeah, yeah. I love that. Where I need to go to one of those parties. What the fuck?
Well, that's the thing. It was her birthday. So at the birthday, you can do whatever you want.
It's very individual. So
maybe you need more friends so you can have more birthdays.
When I go, I mean, I'm still 20, so I've never been in LA and 21. So
that's true. I know it's so weird here because like everywhere else it's 18.
Oh, yeah.
If not 17 in certain places. So it's like, I meet people from anywhere in Europe, and I'm like, oh, like, you're a little baby. And then they're like, I've been drinking for 3 years, and I'm like, what?
No, 16, actually.
I know.
Yeah, wine and beer. Like,
yeah, I'm like, what?
Yeah.
And I'm like, haven't had a drink yet, and they're like, what's wrong with you? They're been smoking, like, chain smoking since they were, like, 15, and I'm like, whoa. Yeah,
it's, oh, my God, it's intense.
It's just a culture thing. Yeah.
Like, also the French people and stuff, like, the kids, they're just like, yeah. We go to dark bunkers here at like 18. Like,
yeah.
It's intense.
But also, I actually don't know if it's like for the better or for the worse because I know firsthand, like, since as Americans, like, we have to wait so long to drink. Like, once people do start drinking, they're like, you know, like in college, like kind of finishing college, and they go super overboard. And like,
it's
really, really intense. And they like, have like these like this like whole like decade of just like over drinking and over partying and like like here and in a lot of European places, I feel like there's a lot more moderation because it's not so restricted. I don't know. I mean, I don't know if that's actually true, but that's how it feels from an outsider's perspective.
It makes sense what you're saying because it is like when you can have something, you kind of don't really want it anymore, and it's like when you're 16, okay, you had your glass of wine, and you know, okay, I'm gonna like die when I'm 90. I can have this for like, I don't know, it's I can't chill. Do the math.
There's
right
no,
now.
Like, rush. Yeah,
yeah, but when you're like in the US, you're like, oh my god, 21, and blah blah blah. I feel like that's just contraproductive. Like it's just,
I don't know. And then also like since it's so late, there's like people will drink, you know, technically illegally, and then there's no regulation, and then it's like, and then it just gets like really, and then bad things happen.
Exactly.
I don't know. I mean, I don't know shit about this. I don't know why I'm talking about it. But
we just kind of
we're just talking
like,
out
it's like
our
there's
asshole.
No cameras. It's like, what's happening?
But I don't know. I have no idea, but it's definitely like the culture is different with partying when like someone somewhere here versus in the States. Like, partying culture is just a very, very different
thing. 1,000%.
I feel like here it's like hugely about music.
Oh yeah. It's not about the alcohol. It's not about the location. We have the most ratchet ass locations.
Yeah. People want to dance.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I love that because LA was very like, I'm here. And I was like,
in LA, people want to smile and surface.
Exactly. What are you doing right now? Like the night that the album's coming out, are you on your blankets in your room with friends or?
It's like, I don't celebrate. Yeah. I don't do like album release party. No.
Cringe, right?
I literally just sit at my house and like go crazy as in like think that the world is ending.
True, because there's a lot of pressure with that.
There's so much pressure.
The bigger you get, it's like, holy shit, all these A&Rs and all these different
people.
But you can relax. Like in the end, it's your art and you get to show it.
Yeah. And so I just sit at my house and... And I'll probably like be FaceTiming my friends.
Yeah.
But I don't do. I don't know why everyone's always like, "Are you so excited for your album to come out?" No, I'm not excited. I'm scared.
I've been hearing this.
I'm
You're
stressed.
Scared. Yeah.
I'm stressed.
But when it's out, it's kind of isn't it like
and
a
then after it's out? Oh my god.
And when
after
you
it's
get
out,
to
you're
perform
like,
it.
Eh. That's all I needed to do.
Yeah. And when you get to perform it, are you going to do like the live setups, like full 80 vibes from the colors and the fiber?
I don't know. I just want to put on a really good show. I don't really know what I'm going to do. But I think also with a live show, it's like, it's about the people there.
Yeah.
Well, it's like sometimes I watch a show and I'm like, why do I feel like this show is being played like at me? I'm like, ah.
Yeah, you want like the energy exchange from like the crowd to the.
It's like, I'm like, this isn't about me. This is about you guys. So I just want to make the show like as good as possible for them. So I don't know. I'll figure it out.
Fun.
Yeah.
Thanks for being on this. Of course. It was really fun talking to you.
Thank you. We said really strange things at 10 in the morning.
We did. I don't know how the fuck this happened, but it's beautiful.
It was beautiful.
Yeah. Happy album. Like, it's like happy birthday, but happy album.
Birthday.
Happy birthday, happy Easter. And yeah, see you guys next time.
Bye.
Bye-bye.